What is up, amigos? Today we're talking about airfoil pressure coefficient curves. And if you don't know what the pressure coefficient is, so this symbol here, check out this video where we've gone through what it is and what it means. And when you first learn pressure coefficient curves, they are quite strange and they can really mess with your mind because of how they're drawn. So let me go through the basics and then a bit more advanced. So overall, what we use this for is often to look at the lift coefficient and the lift production of an airfoil. So we have an airfoil up here, and underneath we have the graph with the y-axis and the x-axis. The x-axis goes from the leading edge, so 0% of the chord, all the way to 100% of the chord, which is the trailing edge. Now, one thing I really need to point out is the y-axis. So in mathematics in general, we have the upper part of the y-axis usually positive and the lower part negative. But when we draw airfoil pressure coefficient curves, it's usually flipped. And the reason why is because we always really want to figure out what the lowest pressure is over the airfoil, because that gives us a good indication as to the lift really being produced. And we'll talk about that in a second so you can understand why that is. But the most important thing to remember is this upper part is almost always the negative pressure and the lower part here is almost the positive pressure. In fact, sometimes you'll see a curve like this where it has negative on top, positive underneath. Sometimes they'll have a negative CP here, positive on top, negative underneath, but because it's negative CP, it's actually negative. So that's what I mean by how it is so confusing. So just make sure to watch out for that aspect every time you get one of these curves. Now let's dive into what this means. So I assume you know what the pressure coefficient curve is from that video. And we have two lines here. The top line is for the top surface, and the bottom line is for the bottom surface, which is also, I guess, another reason why we have negative on top, top line, top surface, bottom line, bottom surface. It helps us visualize it that way. And we see that both lines start from zero. So that means that when the free stream flow comes in, we have zero gauge pressure, and then it hits the airfoil, and we get a stagnation pressure, which if we have the airfoil up at an angle attack, that will occur on the bottom surface, so the pressure surface, which is this underneath side here. So that's why we get this increase in the pressure coefficient. I want to say drop, but because it's positive, it really is increase, and that's because all this flow is crashing into the front and decelerating, dumping all that energy into static pressure, that pressure that they can feel, so like static pressure kind of thing. It's actually the total pressure. And that's the stagnation point there. Then as we go along the bottom surface, the flow starts to increase in velocity, so the pressure drops. So we get this line starting to increase, and sometimes it will cross this x-axis and go into the negative side, other times it won't. Sometimes it will hover underneath. But the important point to note is that it goes from this very positive value to a less positive value and sometimes a negative value. And then it trends towards zero, hopefully. We'll get into that in a second. Let's talk about the upper surface first. So likewise, the upper surface, as the flow comes along, the pressure starts at zero to begin with, which is a gauge. It's the same as what you feel in the free stream flow. Then as the flow goes over the top, we know that the flow accelerates. So it increases in velocity quite a lot. And as such, the pressure will drop dramatically. So we get this massive peak here. And interestingly, this can go up very high. Like you can see values up to -3, -4 in experimental results quite readily. And then as the flow goes over the airfoil down here, the flow starts to decelerate a little bit. And that results in the pressure increasing as well, the pressure coefficient as well. And that means this line starts to trend back towards zero. Now, the important point to note here is that both these lines, for the bottom surface and the top surface, will meet. And this is because as the flow comes along here and here, obviously at the trailing edge, they have to mix. And this results in this pressure from the bottom surface and the pressure from the top surface really equalizing. So that's why they meet here. Now, let's talk about what happens if these two lines don't meet at the x-axis at zero CP. Well, if they meet, let's say around here, then that means that there's actually loss in the flow or anywhere else. If it doesn't meet at zero, then there is some loss in the flow, and that's because we have drag, we have friction drag, we have pressure drag or whatever. So that's not good. If the lines meet at zero, then it means that we have effectively perfectly expanded the flow and then perfectly compressed the flow, so we've changed the pressure pretty much isentropically. And that means that we have there's no loss in the system. So that's something to watch out for there. Now, what about these two lines? What else can we do with them? Well, another thing we can look at is how much lift is really being produced. So from last week's video, if you haven't checked that out, check out this video here, because we go through how to calculate the lift and even the drag from the pressure coefficient and the general pressure over an airfoil. And this ties in very tightly to this concept here. So here we have the graph of the pressure coefficient over the entire airfoil, top surface and bottom surface. So we have all the information we need to figure out what the lift is. So what we do is we can integrate this curve between these two lines, and we can figure out the lift as long as we know what the angle of these surfaces are along this airfoil. So from last week's video, we know that pressure can only act normal to a surface. So let's say we have the CP value here is a certain amount. Well, that obviously isn't just in the lift direction, it's also in the drag direction a little bit, the X and the Y directions. So to find the lift, we need to decompose it into the lift direction, which is this direction here. So as long as we know what that angle is, we know what the CP value is, so we can then calculate the lift at that point, and we can go around this airfoil as such and calculate the entire lift of that airfoil. We do the same for the drag as well. So this graph here is very powerful. It gives us a lot of information as to what this airfoil is doing. From that, we can also figure out where along this airfoil the most amount of lift is being produced. And we can figure that out mainly from the distance, I should say, between the top surface and the bottom surface. So these top lines and bottom lines. So the greater this distance is, generally speaking, the more lift that you're producing. Obviously, as you get to around to the front, this surface becomes more and more curved towards the drag direction. But along this surface here, it's often in the lift direction, so we can use this general idea much more effectively. So we can say here, for example, which coincides with about here, we can say that this point along this airfoil is producing more lift than this point here, where there's a very little distance between this top surface line and the bottom surface line. So that is it's a very powerful thing to be able to do, because now we know how this airfoil is really performing as the flow goes along it. We can then also get a good idea as to if we were to do something to the airfoil, for example, if we were to put a vortex generator here, or if we were to bring in the bottom surface a little bit and sort of taper it up a bit more, how would that really affect this distribution? Because if, let's say, we put a vortex generator here where we're getting a lot of lift being produced, generally speaking, we're potentially going to be messing with that point there and making the airfoil worse in terms of lift production. Alternatively, if we were to take in a tail here, then we may be not really affecting the flow that much, because we're not getting that much lift or drag really out of this point here. So that's going to be a less sensitive region. There are obviously some upstream effects, but this is just a general idea as what we can use this graph for. So that is what the airfoil pressure coefficient is and the curve associated with it and how powerful it is. So if you like this video, make sure to like, click the subscribe button, and I'll see you here. Peace, amigos.